So today we are joined by Antonella Stirati. Before we begin this interview, it is important to make the note that this conference is a collaboration with the Rethinking Economics Institute, and that despite this being pre-recorded, you can all make the questions that you want to Antonella, and then the answers will be published by us on our platforms. So introducing our guest today to talk about post-Keynesian economics. Antonella Stirati is currently a professor of economics at Roma Tre University. She studied economics at the University of Siena, Cambridge in the United Kingdom, and she had her PhD at La Sapienza. Her research interests are in the development of classical Keynesian approach, particularly in the fields of output and employment determination, income distribution, and unemployment. She wrote a book on the theory of wages in classical economics, co-edited the three-volume collection Sraffa and Reconstruction of Economic Theory, and published a number of articles in academic journals and collected volumes. Her article on inflation and employment and hysteresis has been selected as one of the best 25 articles published in the Review of Political Economy since the journal was first issued. She is also active in scientific popularization and intervenes in public debates on current issues. She co-edits the online journal Economia e Politica. So getting into our topic, an introduction to post-Keynesian economics. I think that any theory in a given field of study can't be dissociated from its historical origin, because theories stem from a necessity to develop an idea or a different perspective on the world at the time. So bearing this in mind, Antonella, when was the first post-Keynesian economics first introduced, and how did it change over time?
Okay, thank you for the invitation, for this opportunity. I hope that will be useful to young students and scholars in economics. So concerning your question, I wouldn't say there is a specific date in which there was, no, the school was born, but I would say that, of course, the roots, the origins must be sought in the general theory by Keynes, that the first building, the first stone in the construction, and perhaps the focus for all post-Keynesians. Also in the contribution, the foundations, let's say, maybe founded the contributions of the younger than Keynes, let's say, economists at Cambridge in that same period. So John Robinson, Nicholas Kaldor, and also Sraffa and Kaleski were not strict in the strict sense, in a sense, the collaborators of Keynes, but they were in contact with the, let's say, the environment, the cultural environment of Cambridge. Sraffa was also at Cambridge. Kaleski was there for a while. After that, economists like Davidson, Mischi, Kregel, but also Garegnani and Pasinetti on the Italian side gave important contributions to the construction of the set of ideas, let's say, and models used by post-Keynesian economists. According to Lavoie, to a contribution that I will then indicate at the end of the interview, in fact, the post-Keynesian schools emerged with the consciousness of being an alternative school of thought, the precise school of thought, after the capital controversy in the 1960s. And the capital controversy, we can return on this later on, but was mainly a criticism to the analytical foundations of neoclassical theory, moved by Pasinetti and Garegnani in a famous symposium on the Quarterly Journal of Economics in 1966. So these are broadly the main foundations. Then, of course, there are within this school, like any school of thought, there are differences, no? There are differences among strengths and among individuals, because each individual researcher or intellectual has particular emphasis or interest, but there is some common feature. So let's try to see what are these common features and also where may be some tensions between different economists or schools or strands within this school of thought. So I would say that since I mentioned the general theory, of course, I would say that a core element which is agreed upon by scholars within the post-Keynesian camp is the idea that the Keynesian principle of effective demand is the appropriate theory of output and employment, and the theory, not one theory, the theory of output and employment, okay? Which also means that you are denying that spontaneous market forces will normally bring the economy towards full employment of labor and full utilization of the stock of capital, that is of productive capacity, its physical, you know, the physical stock of capital. So the idea basically is that normally it's aggregate supply that adjusts to aggregate demand for Keynesians, while for the whole neoclassical tradition, it is aggregate supply or potential, if you like, aggregate supply determined by the endowment of factors of production, capital and labor, and technological technical knowledge that determines the aggregate supply, and aggregate demand adjusts to aggregate supply always, okay? So that there is no persistent lack of aggregate demand representing an obstacle to, for example, accumulation or the accumulation of capital or to full utilization of resources. So what are the, of course, if we are saying, if the Keynesian economy, sorry, my telephone, I will put it silent. No problem, just a minute. If the point is that it is aggregate supply that adjusts to aggregate demand, that means that there is something different in the mechanism working behind this adjustment. So what were the neoclassical views, traditional views, put very briefly and simply? On the side of the labor market, you would have that the flexibility of the wage rate brought about by competition, together with a decreasing demand, aggregate decreasing demand for labor with respect to the wage rate, would ensure a tendency to full employment. That is to say, a tendency to produce a level of output. We are always reasoning at the macroeconomic level, and not looking at composition, just levels. So the level of production would be such as the one corresponding, given the existing technologies available, the one corresponding to full employment of labor. So that at that full employment output, there would be a certain amount of savings due to the propensity to save, taste, whatever you like. In order to have aggregate demand, to adjust to aggregate supply, you must have investment, aggregate investment, equal to aggregate savings. So at full employment, you need a mechanism that ensures that investments will be equal to full employment savings. The mechanism was represented before Keynes, but also after Keynes, already with the ESLM model, and still today in more recent a formulation of mainstream macroeconomics. The main reason is that there is an investment function, which is a decreasing function of the interest rate. Okay. And so investments tend to adjust to the supply, no, savings, supply of loanable funds, as it is called sometimes, through changes of the interest rate. These changes may be brought about by market forces, or where market forces don't work very well, they can also be brought about by policy of the central bank that, if it observes a gap in insufficient aggregate demand, may lower the interest rate and stimulate investment. So changes in the interest rate will always ensure that aggregate demand is equal to aggregate supply. This is the main mechanism. Of course, post-Keynesians do not agree, and so they must be critical of this view, okay? Now, looking at the investment issue, for the moment, overlooking the labor side of the story, the labor market side of the story, different strands in post-Keynesian, among the post-Keynesians, have different way or different emphasis on which is the best way to criticize this adjustment through interest rate and investment. Some Keynesians have emphasized the role of exogenous expectations, the role of uncertainty in making the investment function sort of very unstable and so not reliable. And then very close to this idea is the notion that animal spirits is what drives in aggregate investment. So it's something that relates to the expectations of the entrepreneurs. So there is no real systematic function. Others put the emphasis on a different level, and going back to the discussion about the neoclassical capital theory, neoclassical foundations, these economists would say that very simply there is no systematic relation between investment and interest rate, because this systematic relation is the flow counterpart of the decreasing demand for capital as a stock, as a decreasing function of the interest rate. And this is precisely what was shown to be wrong by the capital controversy in the 60s. That controversy showed that even under neoclassical assumption concerning competition, profit maximization, choice of techniques, et cetera, the effect of a change in the interest rate is not necessarily that of increasing the demand for capital as the ratio of capital to labor and of capital to output in the economy on the part of profit maximizing or cost minimizing firms. And the same goes for the demand for labor. So these economists, and I'm one of those, so I clarify my position so you know, think that this is a deeper criticism and in some sense a more solid, more robust analytical criticism. So there is no reason why there should be a decreasing relationship between aggregate investment and interest rate. So there is no such relationship. There is no mechanism that ensures the adjustment of aggregate demand to aggregate supply. And what remains is the Keynesian point of view, which is the reverse. No, it's savings that adjust in a closed economy, very simple economy, but it is savings that adjust to investment through changes in output when aggregate demand changes. So the equilibrium, let's say, the macroeconomic equilibrium between aggregate demand and aggregate supply and between savings and investment is brought about by the completely different mechanism, which in a sense brings to light to the importance of the demand side of the economy, consumption, the propensity to consume, and the amount of investment, okay? So this is the main, different mechanism of adjustment between aggregate supply and aggregate demand as the main common core of post-Keynesian economics. Another, I should say, quite important aspect is that I would say most post-Keynesian economists would be probably quite diffident of the determination of relative prices on the basis of supply and demand curves, based on consumer tastes. And they rather tend to see relative prices as determined by costs of production plus some margin, including profits. There are differences about the determination of profits. The more Sraffian, classical, Marxian side tends to see, competition understood as free mobility of capital across industries, a major force determining a tendency to uniformity of profit rates, with, of course, the existence of monopolies, some form of monopoly barriers to entry, which can determine extra profits, but even extra profits, in a sense, are limited by potential competition, threat of entry of new firms, etc. So the force of competition is very much emphasized in this trend as a force affecting tending to make the rate of profit uniform across industries when there is free mobility of capital. And the causes of profits are seen a bit as in Marx, as in the class conflict around the, profits depend on how much workers manage to get as real wages, basically, okay? Whereas other trends tend to emphasize market power on the part of firms, their ability to apply some markups over costs, which are not so much conditioned by competition and rather reflect the firm's targets in terms of accumulation or other types of targets. So here there are some tensions, but again, there are tensions, but there is also, I would say, an agreement that relative prices do not depend on demand supply mechanisms, which are typical of the consumer theory in neoclassical theory. And of course, there are also several, these are the theory of value and distribution is somehow foundational, not for any economic theory, for the approach to economic phenomena. And on the side, again, I spoke about the theory of value, but the theory of distribution is strongly connected. So I think that most Keynesian would share the view that income distribution does not depend on relative factor scarcity, as in neoclassical theory, but depends on institutional factors, bargaining power, political setup, I mean, a number of economic, for example, the size of unemployment, economic and institutional factors, but not on relative factor scarcity. Said that, of course, there are a number of other, these are the sort of foundational core, then there are a number of other relationships and considerations that probably most post-Keynesian economists would share. One, an important one is the idea that money is endogenous, that is to say that to a large extent, or fully, again, here there may be different interpretations, but the demand for credit is what causes and creates deposits and reserves, so that in a sense, of course, the demand for credit from firms or households who are reliable, that is, who can guarantee solvency, because the commercial banks are private entities, and so they cannot give loans if they don't have a guarantee that they will be returned. But under these conditions, the creation of credit depends on the demand for credit, and this brings with it the creation of deposits and reserves. So this is a view of the working of the monetary system, which is quite different from the traditional one, but I think is also widely shared by post-Keynesian economists. another, I think, quite common idea is that inflation is in most cases, not necessarily in all cases, but in most cases, not a monetary phenomenon, but rather a result of class conflict around class conflict or other types of conflicts between countries through the exchange rate or different social groups and productive sectors, but is the result of conflict over income distribution. Okay. Rather than a monetary phenomenon, there are another common idea is that productivity growth is largely endogenous and caused on the one hand by increasing demand, a la Smith and Calder in a sense. So returns to scale and innovation is driven by the growth of demand and the market and the size of the market. Another also channel for innovation is conflict, a la Ricardo and Marx, in the sense that machinery is introduced because is introduced to a larger degree extent when there is conflict over income distribution, and so it's a way to solve the conflict by pushing the workers out of their jobs and substituting with machinery or mechanization or innovation can be a way to increase the employer's control over manpower or the discipline of the workers and so on. So in this sense, again, there may be the degree of conflict may be a stimulus for certain types of innovation and which also cause productivity growth. Okay, so there are also on this, in this field are other ideas. So, but and there could be many other fields in which there is agreement, but I think we had enough for the moment. Concerning changes over time, I think in a sense there is a development over time of various themes that in many ways were there from the beginning. What I can say is that in recent years, I would say there has been more research work done on the role of aggregate demand as in the process of accumulation. So not just as a theory of the level of output and employment, but also as a driver of growth through particularly through the impact on investment, on private investment. So there have been a lot of production of papers and research concerning demand-led growth, autonomous, the role of autonomous components of demand in driving accumulation and so on. Another important field of research in these recent years have been the changes in income distribution, which have been a major feature of the last decades, changes in so-called functional income distribution with the decrease of the wage share, increasing inequality, etc. All these have been very much studied by post-Keynesian economists. Both concerning the determinants of these changes and their effects on consumption and other, or even on financialization of the economy, increasing household debt and so on. Another field which has been, I think, quite revived in a sense, or growing in recent years, is that of developing a stock flow consistent macro models. Following the inspiration by Winnie Godley, who also was an important applied economist at Cambridge. And these models are usually Keynesian in their inspiration, in the sense that they use that type of view of the working of the economy, the importance of effective demand, etc., but try to develop macro models that are very careful in putting together, let's say, the flow part of the macroeconomic functioning, consumption, income, investment, etc., with the stock components, and so looking also at the financial sector and the balance sheet of various sectors of the economy. So I think these are the main areas which are now, and of course also that of financial markets after the especially after 2008, has been the study of financial markets and the causes and impact of the crisis also have been quite a subject of inquiry. I think there is a lot of consensus concerning economic policy, but maybe we can come back to that in a while.
Okay. You already talked about some of the main concepts of post-Keynesianism and Keynesianism. I would like to change a bit the questions we had planned to ask you. Why do you think it's useful for a young economist like us to learn about post-Keynesianism? What is the usefulness in understanding the reality?
Oh, completely useful in the sense that if you, well, now I don't know if we have time to dwell very much in this, but I think that most, especially applied and policy-oriented contribution by post-Keynesian economists do capture quite well what's happening and what might happen in the future. Whereas if you look, in a sense, getting rid of the smoke, sometimes the prestigiousness that is derived by top journals, complicated models, a lot of math, a lot of statistics, etc. Most mainstream theory, and I talk especially about macroeconomics because it's the field I know better, is looking at the real world, and what they see is just puzzles. Everything is a puzzle because everything is strange because it's not consistent with the foundations of the theory. And so most of the contributions, in fact, are all aimed at trying, in a sense, I would say, one looks with a bit of detachment, even desperately trying to reconcile facts and theory. And they need a lot of ad hoc assumption. It's full of ad hoc assumption. Whereas I personally, but I think most of my colleagues sharing, you know, a broadly Keynesian approach, do not have many troubles in understanding what's going on. For example, for me, it's quite understandable why in Italy and in many other European countries after 2008 there was a persistent crisis for a while and then a long stagnation, we never recovered, etc. Well, for a neoclassical economist, it's not so easy to explain, no? Because we should have moved quickly back to full employment. So, well, of course we didn't, because there are no endogenous market mechanisms that bring us back to full employment. And on the opposite, we did policies, fiscal policies particularly, that were very much restrictive or in any case, not stimulating enough the economy to bring it back to a, if not to full employment, to something more close to full employment than what we see today. So, and this is just one simple example, but there are many other more, perhaps a bit more technical concerning the relationship, for example, between real wages and employment, or the relationship between reforms of the labor market and why they did fail in most cases in producing less unemployment or more growth, etc., etc. So seen with the neoclassical lens, the world is a real puzzle, while seen from post-Keynesian lens, roughly understandable, and then you, of course you need to go deeper in order to be able to produce adequate, appropriate policy prescriptions or detailed analysis, etc., but it's not puzzling. So in that sense, I think it is useful because it's better. And not all of the approaches are on the same level.
Of course, we have talked a lot about macroeconomics so far. But we were curious to try to understand in what other fields of economics can post-Keynesianism be the most useful. So, and also inside macroeconomics, in which dimensions is post-Keynesianism most accurate or the most complete theory in your opinion?
Okay, so concerning the first question, I would say one very important contribution of the critical side I mentioned, concerning post-Keynesian economics in a broad sense, is that you free the analysis from the constraint of the neoclassical theory, which is very deterministic, no? Everything, you know, you have this regular decreasing demand function for factors of production, a tendency to full employment. If you don't tend to full employment, you must find some specific explanation, some rigidity, something preventing the market forces to work, etc. Prices are a reflection of relative scarcity of everything, but particularly of factors of production. Both the prices of factors of production and the prices of commodities reflect relative scarcity, and so they are also efficient in a sense they reflect if they are determined by free market forces, let's say. They reflect some kind of optimality of the system. Everything else is a distortion, a misallocation, causing unemployment, causing inefficient allocation of resources, etc. If you decide to accept, as I think it should be done on intellectual grounds, let's say, the criticism that were moved in the 60s and get rid of this systematic decreasing relationship between factor prices and their demand, and then in fact get rid of the entire building, okay, because those are the fundamental constants, then, and you take some other constants, which you need, of course, the theory of effective demand as a theory of output, theory of prices based on income distribution and cost of production, and so on. Then the result is that your analysis is very free in all fields. So if you have to decide whether a very simple example, if you have to decide whether the price of the buses that provide public transportation in any big city in Europe, no, the prices of those tickets should be determined by the market or determined by the local administration, or should be free because we want people to use public transportation rather than the automobile. If you are a neoclassical man or woman, you have to answer it should be determined by the market, but because that's the only efficient way to determine it. Any other way will cause some kind of distortions. You have to take care of that, and that has always a bad side in it, okay? Then you might consider that there might be externalities, that pollution, and then very complicating reasoning, what is the implicit cost of various things. If you are not a neoclassical, and that's in some sense a post-Keynesian, You know that the deciding the price of the bus ticket is a political question that can be drawbacks or advantages on one side or another side, but you don't need to get worried about optimal allocation of resources, because these prices do not have anything to do with the optimal allocation of resources. Okay, so there are a number also of so-called microeconomic problems where you get rid of some constraint of neoclassical theory. Of course, you don't have, as a result, you don't have any general system. So you don't have a general principle or a general theory telling you that the price of the bus ticket should be determined by the market. So you have to decide and you have to take account many things. And the answer may be different, because maybe in Madrid, the answer has to be different from the answer you provide in Rome or in New York, depending on several considerations. But so in a sense, things become more difficult, but also become much more, I think, concrete in the sense that in many areas you don't have a general recipe. You have to look at, you'd have to know some connection between things and so on. But you have to look at the specificity of the situation. Another example, what is the effect of a devaluation on the trade balance? This is a much debated topic. Well, I think the answer is not the same for different countries. For Italy, I think one could say that at least in the short to the medium run, a devaluation of the exchange rate can be very useful in rebalancing the trade balance, let's say, because Italy is a manufacturing country with a certain type of productive structure and so on. A devaluation in Argentina or in Brazil probably would not have any positive effect on the trade balance and would have a number of negative effects of other type on income distribution, etc. So of course you have to know something about the connection between the exchange rate and other economic variables. You cannot reason in emptiness, but you also have to know about the productive structure, the social structure and so on of a specific economy in order to be able to say what is the effect. For neoclassical theory, if you have any imbalance, if you change the price, everything goes well. Which is, in this case, they would say if there is a deficit in the trade balance, you have to devaluate the exchange rate. No, so I think that the difference is that you have always general principles that usually do not match the fact. And on this side, you have a few much less general principles. But you have the tools to try to understand the differences in different situations.
Thank you. We'll go to the next question. I would like to go to a personal note, if you may. This edition is the king of, in this edition is pluralism, especially on this day. And I'd like to ask you, as a professor, what do you think is the role in pluralism in economics today? What could be or should be the role, and how do you apply pluralism in your teaching?
Okay, various things about pluralism. First of all, I think it's extremely important in education, but also in scientific research. So it's not just important for students, but it's important for scholars. Because if you have constantly to compare to, different views, as a student, you are forced to think about it, just not take, everything passively. And as a researcher, you're forced to be very good because someone who does not share your same foundations, views, etc., will be very critical, and you have to be able to defend yourself from the criticism. So you must be sure that what you do is very well grounded. And I think that this lack of comparison, I don't know how to call it, between different approaches, not just in the result of applied research, but on the analytical basis of economic analysis and also of applied research, is very detrimental. It's very detrimental for students because often they don't even understand what they do or what are the analytical basis of what they do. It's a very unusable, I think, way of learning economics, especially in American textbook, where there is a strong tendency to present theories as they were fact. So the consumer theory is not presented as a theory, it's presented as a fact, that is that you know somehow from some data or looking at the consumer at the supermarket that there is this marginal substitution, et cetera, et cetera. Which is not true, no? So that's a theory as a deductive component, a very strong deductive component, and then you may try to test it and see if it matches the facts. And for the researchers as well, I think this segmentation of economics is very bad because worsen the quality both of the critical side, let's say, of the post-Keynesian, if you like, and the of neoclassical. But said that, I think that what has happened in the recent past is that there has been in all countries, in Italy it's very strong, but I think everywhere it is very strong. The mainstream has been able, through a number of even institutional processes or criteria which have been which have become widespread for recruitment of young researchers and so on, has managed to impose some criteria to evaluate merit, to promote careers, to hire people and so on, which, or to publish papers on journals, which are very much one-sided, I would say even ideological, so that there is less and less space for things which are different, which are critical, and universities are less and less plural in the sense that the teaching tends to be the same everywhere and very little critical. Or deep, you know, deep into the questions. So I think in this respect, the role of students should be, could be, and should be very important in the sense that I think that the things can change a bit, and there can be more introduction of courses in the fields of history of thought, post-Keynesian economics. Studying Keynes, studying Marx, studying major figures, Schumpeter, well, I mean, major figures in the history of economic thought that can stimulate thinking about certain important phenomena in economics. Asking for this on the part of students can have some impact. And I don't think there is another route. The system will not self-reform. It will reform, it will sort of widen a bit the what students get and learn only if students demand for it. And that I think is very important. Otherwise, in a few years, not even decades, there will be mainstream economics only everywhere.
Yeah, that was extremely insightful. We are arriving at the final moments of our conversation, and to finish off, I think anyone who sees this and gains an interest in this theory and wants to learn more would adore to have some literature recommendations. So
Course, this was a very difficult process because, of course, there is a huge amount of literature. So let me say what I decided to suggest is not the obvious, because, of course, there are many books on post-Keynesian economics. To mention one, Marc Lavoie, a recently published book, etc. But the obvious ones you will find by yourself since you are bright young students. So what I suggest is less obvious perhaps, but it's what I found as a student very illuminating. So these are the three papers by Pierangelo Garegnani published between the end of the 70s and the first two are in fact two parts of one single contribution and then a third contribution on the classical economist. And these are, in a sense, reflect the more constructive part of Carignani's contribution, while usually he is best known for the critical part, the critical to the critiques to the capital, neoclassical capital theory. And the fourth one, still by Carignani, was published only in Italian, has recently been translated and published in Review of Political Economy. And together with a symposium on the role of effective demand in growth processes, which might interest you. Then, if you want to go a bit, perhaps a bit more difficult reading, but if you want to get into some controversy or debates within the post-Keynesian camp, that book, and there are two contributions in this book, which has a very nice cover, by the way, which is the third volume of a collection of papers from a conference on Sraffa held in Rome. And the introduction by myself and then the contribution by Marc Lavoie and Tonia Spromurgos are very informative, I think, about the tensions within, or the differences, not necessarily tensions, within the post-Keynesian camps between, you know, different strands. And then the last one is a working paper, so it's very easy to get because you go to the place and download it for free. And that just, I mean, it was written with the view of being pedagogical. So it's an attempt to be quite clear and to address mostly young students and give a sense of different theories of employment along a long time span, let's say, from Smith to contemporary economics. So that's these are my suggestions, and I hope you will enjoy reading these difficult papers.
Thank you very much, Professor Antonelli. I'd like to remark again that for those of you that are watching, you can make questions. And this is the end. It was really lovely, Professor Antonelli. We are really appreciative of your time. It's a huge honor having you with us today. And I wish you the best of luck for your professional and personal life. And for us, I don't know if you have any last words that you'd like to say.
Well, in any case, we will meet again for the questions, I think. But just perhaps a last remark on pluralism. Having said that, I think it is extremely important that different approaches do, you know, confront and are presented to the students and exist, I mean, in an academic debate and talk to each other. This is very important. So that pluralism doesn't mean that everything is true and everything can be applied according to the context. And this would be a too easy way out, let's say, of the difficulties of choosing. So there are some instances, as I made some example, in which you can have different answers to the same question according to the situation. So you have to look at specific features of the problem, of the country, of the situation, of the institutional setting, and so on. But concerning the cornerstones of theories, the core of theories, you cannot have both neoclassical theory holding and not holding concerning what determines income distribution. Either it's correct and then that is the theory of income distribution, or it's not correct and then you need to have another theory. You cannot have both at the same time. Okay, this was just my final remark.
Thank you very much, and we'll end the session like this and see you all.
Thank you for the patience and the time, and see you again.
Thank you.